Well, let me first join Suzanne in saying how much we enjoy being here, seeing your wonderful country, and seeing the excitement among so many young people. It harbors well for the future of science in Malaysia. As you've already heard from Suzanne's talk, what I'll be telling you about today is the long saga of how a discovery that we made in our lab in 1988, namely that the BCL2 protein functioned in tumor genesis by preventing cell death, how that discovery in recent years has led to a new class of drugs that look very promising. Now, you've already seen this slide from Suzanne, but it is the central aspect of my lecture, and so it is worthwhile repeating the main ideas. First of all, the BCL2 life death switch has three components. At the top, so-called BH3-only proteins, which are the signaling molecules, are saying that cell death should occur. But it's really the balance between them and the pro-survival protein that determines whether that actually happens. And what the pro-survival proteins do is simply to stop the activation of Vaccin-Back, because they are the deadly effector molecules that cause the permeabilization of the mitochondrial outer membrane, so making it leaky. So that essentially ensuring cell death. In fact, most cells would die even if the caspases were not activated. So they do a tidier job. So the whole idea of this new search for a new class of drugs is that if we could get a small molecule, in other words, a drug, that behaves similarly to a BH3-only protein, that it might be able to directly trigger cell death in a much more efficient manner, and it would be a new approach to cancer therapy. But this is much easier said than done, and that's because of things that Suzanne also told you. It's essentially that the pro-survival proteins have a rather long and shallow and largely hydrophobic groove on their surface. And you can see here a BH3-only domain fitting into that, but you see it's very spread out. And so this long, shallow, and hydrophobic groove is the target for the new class of drugs that I'm going to be talking about. But if you think about it, this is a very difficult sort of target. Most drugs are designed against particular enzymes, and they usually have a very deep pocket, a single pocket. This is essentially maybe four or five pockets sort of spread along the surface of the molecule. So it's much more challenging. Nevertheless, work at Abbott Laboratories actually succeeded in making the first authentic BH3 mimetic, named ABT-737. And you can see that it's a rather large molecule. If you know anything about drugs, this is about four times bigger than most drugs. In fact, it was considered to be way too big to possibly work. And on the left-hand side with the structure, what you see is that in stick form is the structure of ABT-737 bound to one of the BCL2 relatives, namely uh, BCL XL. So it sits in the same pocket as the BH3-only domain would work, but in fact it only involves two of the pockets. So it's an approximation to the way the BH3-only protein works. But in a sense, it's a crude approximation. The best that can be done when you're using organic molecules to try to mimic something that's been designed to work with a peptide. Fortunately, this work was done in Suzanne's lab, tested the ability of ABT-737 to kill a particular type of lymphoma that our lab had developed. Very aggressive sort of lymphoma. One that involves both BCL2 and MYC being altered. And interestingly, you can see from this simple graph that mice bearing that sort of tumor by transplantation die very quickly. It's shown in red. All are dead by 30 days. But there's a pronounced improvement in their survival if they're treated with the drug ABT-737. Now, this is an early indication that this drug might be very useful. And I'll talk a bit more about that later. I want to emphasize, however, that the process of drug development is long, challenging, and expensive. If you have something that looks good in the lab, only about 1% of such drugs will actually make it all the way through to clinical application. The reason, first of all, is a huge process of actually finding a chemical that can do what you want it to do. And then there's the problem of testing, very careful testing that has to occur in the clinic. Basically, to find out, does it work? And secondly, is it in fact safe? Or does it actually cause more damage than it does good? And so for that reason, only about 1% of potential drugs reach the clinic. And I won't talk too much about all the different stages of clinical development, but I'll just talk to you in a little bit more detail about how one goes from a target molecule to a good lead for possibility of being a drug. I want to emphasize as a start that it's a really iterative process in which you gradually find compounds that bind better and are more effective, and then from a screening effort, you eliminate ones that are obviously unsuitable until you finally get to a clinical candidate. To show the screening process in a little bit more detail, first you have to develop an effective assay, validate it, show that it works. Then you have to do a primary screen of thousands of compounds. Then you have to make sure how many of those can be confirmed in further screens, in what we call a counter screen, which is another way of eliminating the false positives. And finally, you try to have as much data as you can about a very effective hit compound. And then you get into the medicinal chemistry, which as I'll explain in a minute. First of all, you need a good assay. And the type of assay that works when you're trying to deal with thousands of compounds is often very different from the kind of assay that you would use as a biochemist in the lab, where you might be dealing with 10 samples or 20 samples or 30 samples. There's a big difference. When you're dealing with thousands, you need a very efficient process. And the one that our institute started using is very simple. It involves these special beads, donor beads and acceptor beads. And on the donor bead, you put, for example, the protein target, in this case, one of the BCL2 family members. And on the acceptor bead, you put the peptide that you believe and have established can bind to the protein, such as the BIM-BH3 peptide. And then when you do the assay, these beads are designed such that when they're brought close together, for example, by the peptide binding to the protein, which is the usual way it would happen, if there's no compound around, the binding of the BHP peptide to the target protein produces a light signal, which I'll show here like this. And so here's how a primary screen can be done, the way it was actually done in our institute. First of all, you're not usually working with test tubes, but it's too inefficient to be manipulating thousands of tubes. You're actually usually working with a plastic thing, tray, that has a large number of wells, in this case 1,536 wells. And so all the assay is done in small, very small volumes. And when these experiments were done, it was a few microliters. I believe with current improvements, it would now probably be much less than a microliter. So that saves a lot of money in terms of the screen, and it also means that you can do much bigger screens. And finally, the assay is actually read in a plate reader, so it reads the whole plate of 1,536 wells in a matter of minutes once the assay has happened. And so down at the bottom, you can see that with the appropriate robotic setup, all this is done by robotic automation, you can do as many as 70,000 assay points in 24 hours. So this shows how, if once you get it properly set up, it's possible even for an academic lab to be doing high throughput drug screening. So, we started out to try to find so-called BHP inhibitors. And here I'm really talking about a number of chemists that were hired by our institute, medicinal chemists. And they had assembled a library of over 107,000 compounds. And we did a screen. But also, let me emphasize that this can be a chancy business, because our screen only yielded one weak hit out of the 107,000. Nevertheless, our medicinal chemists then got excited, and they then prepared, purified, and tested dozens of derivatives of that hit. And then our structural biologists at our institute got involved. And they determined the structure of the lead compounds bound to the target protein usually by X-ray crystallography in our place, but it can also be done by NMR. And that's very important because it reveals exactly how the lead is binding. And if you see a number of leads binding in the same sort of way, you know you're on the right track. But it can also suggest many new modifications that might be prepared. You may see that there's a pocket nearby in the structure that's not occupied, and maybe you need to make an extension in that direction to get an even better compound. And finally, the iterative process of all this medicinal chemistry and tests actually ended up with a compound that was about 10,000-fold higher affinity than the initial hit. So just finding a hit is just a start. Then you've got the process of trying to improve it so that it will be in the target range of working in vivo. And this led to the first paper that described a selective inhibitor of a close relative of BCL2 called BCL-XL. But in terms of our own careers and perhaps the most important outcome of this search for a BSU genetic was that it attracted the attention, of Genentech, a leading U.S. Biotech firm, who approached us because they knew about our deep understanding of the BCL2 family, and they were very impressed by the efforts we had made in our own BSU genetic discovery. So we entered into a research collaboration with them, and then subsequently we were joined by Abbott, who had developed the very first such compound, ABT-737. And we had a four-year research collaboration, very unusual situation for an academic institute to be linked with two different major pharmaceutical companies, but it worked. And the outcomes, I'll show you in a minute, was one of the most promising of the new drugs. But first, to go backwards a little bit, I want to talk about what happened with the close derivative of ABT-737 called ABT-263, and the generic name for it is navitoclax. When these drugs finally sort of start making it into the clinic, they're giving a generic name, no matter what they were called before that. And interestingly enough, this work by our close colleague Andrew Roberts showed that, in fact, this prototype drug did have potential. Now, he works on chronic lymphocytic leukemia, one of the most common forms of leukemia. And it was a particularly interesting disease because it has high levels of BCL2, which is one of the proteins that's hit by ABT-263. Three of the family members are hit by it. And it was already known that primary CLL cells have a marked sensitivity in vitro to ABT-263. And Andrew Roberts' work with other clinicians showed promising, though in some ways unsatisfactory results with the first patients. Namely, about 50% of almost all of them had some reduction in circulating tumor cells, perhaps maybe greater than 50%. And about a third of them achieved what was described as a partial remission. So it was an exciting finding, but it had its limitations. And the biggest problem was that it turned out that the drug caused a problem with the platelets. And I show here the balance between BCL2 and VAC, one of the key effector proteins, in controlling platelet lifespan. The reason that was important is that platelets are needed for blood clotting. And so this was a threatening situation for cancer patients who already had quite a disturbed hematopoiesis already. And so the damage, the drop in platelets became the dose-limiting toxicity for navitoclax. What this means is that the first thing you do in the clinic is try to gradually increase the dose of the drug until you start running into serious complications. And they could not push this far enough because of the drop in platelets. Thanks. Therefore, our colleagues in the consortium proceeded to try to make a drug that would be very specific simply for BCL2 without the complications of target hitting the other proteins. And that emerged from the collaboration. A new compound called ABT-199 was made by making about four or five critical modifications to the original navitoclax. It's totally specific for BCL2, and it has sub-nanomolar affinity for it. And its binding to other pro-survival proteins is over 1,000-fold weaker. It potently kills cells that are dependent upon BCL2, but not ones that depend much more on BCL-xL. So it seemed very promising. And in fact, early preclinical studies certainly showed that was the case. And then finally, the drug was approved for clinical trial, and here are some of the very first results that were obtained. Basically, you can see from the central panel that the tumor cells plummeted immediately. So that within one day, there was about a 95% kill of the tumor cells. And there was a rapid reduction also in the palpable lymph nodes that arise with this kind of leukemia. In fact, the tumor killing was so fast and extreme that later on it was important to adjust the doses considerably, to use a slow ramping up of the dose, because you had the possibility of actually killing the patient by too much tumor lysis, sort of flooding the patient with more tumor debris than the system could handle. And so ABT-199, as well as being a dynamite drug, it also had, as expected, had no effect on platelet levels because they're determined by BCL-xL. And just one example shows the effect of the reduction in lymph nodes in a man with CLL after a few weeks of therapy. But a more scientific presentation is shown in the next slide, which looks at the drop in tumor cells in the blood or in the lymph nodes by a different measure, or in the bone marrow by yet another way of measuring. And you can see that in all cases, a huge proportion of the patients responded with from 50% to 100% effects on the tumor cells, getting rid of the tumor cells. So in fact, this drug, which is now called venetoclax, the generic name, has now become the first BH3 mimetic drug approved for routine clinical use. US FDA approved venetoclax for treating a particular form of refractory or relapse CLL. This is a disease that's very difficult to deal with. In fact, many of the patients in that initial trial, I forgot to say, had already undergone many other forms of therapy which had failed. And so this was their last chance. And so the impact of the drug has been important already and is now approved for similar indications in Europe and in Australia. And there's a lot of research going on now how best to use venetoclax in many other leukemias, lymphomas, and even other types of cancer. It looks like rational combination therapies, as often happen in cancer, will be particularly effective. For example, there's a treatment for CLL that involves an antibody against a protein that's present on the B lymphocytes that are expanded in CLL. And if that drug is combined with venetoclax, the number of complete remissions, that is where you can really see no evidence of tumor anymore, has gone from 20% with venetoclax alone to about 58%. And this subset of patients, in fact, lack detectable tumor cells even by the most sensitive technique, raising the possibility that they've actually been cured. At the moment, more than 60 clinical trials are going on worldwide to try to work out the best ways to use. Now I want to spend a minute talking about what is a puzzle, probably to us as well as you. Why does this process work, given that it's something that's in all the cells of the body, involves targeting something that's in all our cells? Why does it kill tumor cells effectively and not kill the normal cells? We believe that the reason is that the tumor cells have in fact had many oncogenic changes, have generated stress, and that has caused the accumulation of BH3-only proteins and also then selection for pro-survival proteins. So that you have a buildup of complexes, for example, the BH3-only protein BIM bound to BCL2 shown on the left side. So what happens when the venetoclax comes along, it strongly binds to BCL2 specifically, but that frees BIM, and BIM can then go and hit other molecules, for example, MCL1, or it may even hit BAX and trigger apoptosis directly. So that's why we think that tumor cells are more vulnerable than normal cells. So, there's been this success in targeting BCL2, but what about other BCL2 family members? Remember, there are about 5 different pro-survival proteins closely related to BCL2. And we think one of the most promising is MCL1. And the reason for thinking that is, first of all, that the MCL1 gene is frequently amplified in human tumors. That means the cells have undergone selection for having higher amounts of the MCL1, and that's been done by gene amplification. And furthermore, tumors that relapse often have high MCL1 and high MCL1 makes cells resistant to, for example, ABT199. But the most compelling data, mostly derived from some of our colleagues in Melbourne, is that in mice, acute loss of MCL1 provokes marked tumor attrition in both lymphomas, leukemias, and myelomas, which are a late stage of antibody-producing cell. So this is direct experimental evidence that MCL1 is important for maintaining all those types of blood cell cancers. For this reason, since 2014, BI scientists, our close colleagues, have collaborated with Servier, a French pharmaceutical company, in preclinical studies of their promising MCL1 inhibitor to try to see if we could push it along to get evidence that would allow it to go into the clinic. And the work from that study has been published recently as a lead article in Nature. And here I show one experiment from that study in which a particular human myeloma cell line has been put into mice, and then the survival of those mice has been monitored if they were treated or untreated or treated with different levels of the MCL1 inhibitor. And you can see that there's a stunning effect on the volume of that tumor with different, depending on how much of the MCL1 inhibition is present, with essentially nearly all of it being eliminated with the highest dose that was used. And similar results were obtained with a number of other blood cell cancers, and even a couple of solid tumors showed some effects. And here's an experiment actually done in mice so that we could match up what happened to the tumor and what happened to the mice. And the mouse survival was greatly increased with these aggressive EMU-MYC lymphomas. And in fact, the efficacious doses did not do any damage to the mouse hematopoiesis or tissues. That's very encouraging because it suggests that probably this drug is going to turn out to be safe to use in the clinic. And phase one clinical trials are presently ongoing, which will really nail that down, whether it's safe or not. I seem to be going one step forward and one step backwards. So just to finish up, what I tried to tell you is that after a long period of time, after all our original discoveries in 1988, it's been possible to develop a new cancer therapeutics, which we believe are going to have exciting potential. First of all, because the direct engagement with the apoptosis machinery makes cell death more efficient and selective with less unknown side effects. Secondly, the second point will probably seem a little bit obscure to you unless you realize that one of the most common things that happens, mutations that happens to cells that causes them to become tumorigenic, is to have mutations in the tumor suppressor gene called P53. But fortunately, this class of drugs act downstream of where P53 acts. And so we believe that, and it's so far has held up in an experiment, that even tumors with defective P53 will still be vulnerable. This approach is not mutagenic, unlike many standard cancer drugs. And it could be that the mutagenic effects of cancer drugs are partly responsible for some of the relapses that happen with conventional therapy. Also, the mechanism of action of these drugs is well understood, which isn't always the case, surprisingly enough, with conventional agents. And the final point is that this is not a method, an approach, which is restricted to a particular type of mutation in a tumor or into a particular type of cell type, because it involves a universal cell death control mechanism. And so it could be relevant to diverse cancer types. That remains, of course, to be tested in the clinic. And I believe that that's all I've got to say. Thank you for your attention.